particular areas, you could actually give people a leaflet and they'd go away and sort it out for themselves. But actually those type of targeted approaches are kind of the way that you expect things to change in the future at neighbourhood level. And for primary care leadership to be a key part of making that shift. Community engagement's really important in terms of thinking about how problems for local communities are solved and what investments are made and all of those sorts of things. So again, what we'll see is at the moment when we talk about neighbourhoods, we talk about health and care as if it's this big and the rest of the community as if it's this big. But actually as we move forward, what we'll see is that the community element will be 80% and the health and care element will be 20%. Because I think the focus needs to be on the whole community, how that develops, how it engages with. If we think of social isolation as being one of our biggest problems and loneliness, then clearly what we need to do is change that by engaging much better at that level. We've got a huge army of people in the community and voluntary sector, and our approach needs to unlock that army and work with it. So just to show that we're in line with thinking nationally from NHS England, NHS England presented a picture in terms of what an integrated care system might look like from a regional level, which is in our case the northwest, population of 5 to 10 million. And this chart shows what they would do overall in terms of thinking about the system overall, what the key mandates are for that system, what the key issues are for it overall. System level, which in our case is Cheshire and Merseyside, with a plus population, and looking at the system as a whole, through to place, which again in our case is rural, and council are big providers working together, other sectors as well as NHS providers across the board, and then clearly down to neighbourhood level, where we're talking about networks of delivery working really closely together to proactive and provide the right integrated approaches to people at that level. So again, this chart just gives a kind of, I suppose, a picture that reflects national opinion in what we're doing. In terms of the direct practice, then some of the key things that have been developed at the moment, integrated care teams, working together in terms of working as a multidisciplinary team to support people. Now that brings some challenge in terms of moving away from organisation-based staff to staff working together to the best interests of the population in their local area, and we're clearly working through that. It's also meant that we've needed to work on tools that enable us to understand the different types of risk in local areas and people who are at the most risk. So during this financial year and going forward, there will continue to be a lot of work on those people who are at the highest level of risk of being admitted into hospital, identifying frail old people as well. But as we go forwards, then clearly there are opportunities of a much broader approach on top of that. But those working practices will be something that we absolutely need to underpin the way we move forward. We've also seen, I'll illustrate this a bit more later on, that involving the voluntary sector enables us to work with people without those kind of clinical issues, but actually in a way that's significantly better for the healthcare system. I'm going to pick up that in terms of the example of some work that we've been doing with UK a bit later on in the presentation. I wanted just to be clear that neighbourhoods isn't happening in a vacuum. It is absolutely linked and takes forward the Healthy Wirral mission and vision, and is absolutely about delivering that. So if you think about what that vision is, it's all about how we enable people to live longer and healthier lives and to improve their health and well-being. And by working together in a collaborative way that ensures that organisations work for the better good of their organisation, then we absolutely believe that we can get the very best health and care services as soon as possible. And clearly we're talking about a broader vision than that as well. But it's useful just to reflect on that because helping you is a significant program. This is the current map in terms of the way neighbourhoods look and the current alignment in terms of practices. Now, clearly there is work being undertaken at the moment within primary care where the practices are working out how they want to work together in a primary care network, and that those units of delivery we are hoping will fit with this map as well as we can. But we know at this point in time that there are further discussions to be had. There's a lot of work taking place within GPs and cross GPs to work out how best they can do this and how best they can have something that makes sense to them. Now, that's really important because a lot of the funding that currently goes to practices will be coming direct through into this model, the primary care network model. So for a general practitioner, it's a really big thing that's happening, and it could be almost half of their income comes through this route. So it's got to be right for primary care as well as right in terms of where people live. So we're looking to try and get as much balance there as we possibly can. The next slide just really illustrates that within the neighbourhood approach, as well as the neighbourhoods in the place, what we're seeing is a whole range of people involved in that, particularly in relation to the community and the quality sector support. Our key aim being to provide that one team model in our area. I'm thinking about it. Just as an illustration, just as some work on connectors, community connectors, because we understood as commissions there were a number of different ways that connectors are currently commissioned, a whole range from some that are commissioned through the social care budget, some that have been commissioned through public health, some that are commissioned through other schemes. And what we found is that for every neighbourhood, on the basis of 9 neighbourhoods, there are a minimum of 6 connectors already within each neighbourhood. So they are, you know, there's a whole range of them. They do different things, but clearly one of the key things we need to do is connect the connectors, weirdly. But that's, you know, that's something that we absolutely need to do because we know the resources out there. And if those connectors are helping us to recruit and support a voluntary sector, a social sector, then what we get is a much larger group of people that are helping us to deliver this programme. So some of the work we've done so far helps us to understand that this type of approach is much better for staff, primarily because of the relationships that are developed at the front line. So rather than arguments about referral pathways and feeling fed up with other agencies because their routes don't fit with what we would want and the time it takes to respond and all of those things, what happens within the neighbourhood model is that people work much more closely together, get to know each other and kind of understand each other's priorities and pressures. It's really important part of it. It makes a huge difference, both in terms of the response time, responsiveness, but also the quality of the working relationship at a local level. Given the workforce is a significant issue right across the sector, then that's a really important part of this. Clearly, the people themselves are a core focus of what we want to do in the world. So, again, what we've seen and what we've heard from people is that being treated as an individual and having a flexible response that really is interested in what's important to you, what matters to you rather than what the matter is with you, then what we're seeing is that people can figure that they're getting a much better service as opposed to a prescribed service based on a service delivery model. So again, these sorts of changes are quite significant. But we've got to keep working on it, we've got to keep working on the cultural shifts that are important within this. And clearly from a social care perspective, one of the really important steps is integrating our social workers alongside nurses, alongside therapists, so that they're all working in the same teams to be able to offer this type of response. This slide's been out of date now, and that's because we made really good progress in terms of our initial approach of developing the framework around neighbourhoods. But actually, the development of primary care networks now brings some new challenges in terms of working to respond to that, working alongside primary care to develop that in a way that makes sense. And clearly what we want to do is then make sure that the alignment of resources and the improvement colleagues and all of those sorts of things are lacking in the context of that piece of work. So that will unfold and develop over the next month or so, and we should have a much clearer idea around about mid-May of what that looks like and be able to consider that and what the implications. This is a really boring slide, but it fits with the kind of governance structure that we looked at in terms of Healthy Wirral. So underneath that Healthy Wirral programme, we're going to look at the Neighbourhood programme. Then the Neighbourhood programme itself has a programme structure. And we have different people involved in delivering different levels of that. Senior change team, who are people that provided the project leads, come from each of the key organisations across Wirral. And we have an operational lead, a strategic lead, and a clinical lead from each of those organisations. So what we're getting is a rounded view as to what's required and how this programme should develop. And this slide is just really shows it's a formal structure to it. And this slide clearly needs updating because it's in the old governance structure as opposed to the new governance structure. But again, it just shows that it's a formal programme and a formal structure. More importantly, I wanted to just reflect a little bit on the personal independence coordinator work that's been undertaken with AGK. And this is one example of many where what we're seeing is the role of the voluntary sector in reducing pressure in the care and health system is significant. So what happened here was that the personal independence coordinators in South Wirral B have focused in on those people that have been accessing GP services an awful lot. And what they've done is they've worked to see, well, what can we do to intervene and how can we help people. And what they found was through doing some very simple and straightforward sort of things, offering advice and support in a non-clinical, non-care way, they were able to reduce the amount of appointments that people were taking hugely. So one example I had was one lady who was not well hydrated, was given one of those water bottles with the gauge on the side saying she was drinking. She was advised and turned out what she should be drinking every day. She started to do that. Didn't have time at all, reduced access to the GP because she was able to understand what she needed to do to keep herself healthy and well. Very simple, very straightforward sorts of things. But it needs to be supported. It's absolutely key to these types of ways of working to ensure that we're getting the best from the care and health system, actually, so that people can access it as well. So in terms of the priorities, then there's a lot of work at the moment in terms of the operating model. Clearly, that links to the primary care networks as well and their development, and that. But it's about how providers will work together in provider networks across the neighbourhoods and what relationships they need to have to be able to do this. So clearly that's going to be very important because at the moment we focus a lot of energy on the big NHS providers. Those big NHS providers will be working alongside primary care, will be working alongside community care sector, etc. So those relationships are we will continue to focus on engagement and development of the third sector, and we see a significant role for public health in enabling us to do that and bringing together the world together, work alongside and helping the world to make sure that that's developed in such a way as to really get the best from the sector and the sector to improve its capability. Population health management is significant, and also the information that is available at neighbourhood level about what's happening in the local population, what the key issues are for them in terms of their priorities, but also what the key issues are in terms of health inequalities, disease and all those sorts of things that enable each of the areas to focus. They have some plans at the moment, but those plans will obviously be reviewed and revisited with the advent of the network. Last one. Oh, that's a
click in the picture of him here.
I can play the video, which is only a few minutes, or people can just watch the video.
Can I ask what others would like? I know it's only a couple of minutes. Would you like to sit?
Yeah.
I'm hoping that. I hope something might happen.
If the person's inside the picture, it should as well.
Oh, there we go.